This week on Ebert Presents at the Movies, Courtney Cox and David Arquette return to the franchise that scared us to death. It's Scream 4.
Robert Redford takes a page from the history books in The Conspirator.
Stand down, counselor.
Plus, Roger reviews the new Anne Hathaway, Jesse Eisenberg movie, Rio.
We're gonna die!
Killer didn't call you?
No. Is that a bad thing? Does that mean that I'm not gonna live as long as these two?
No. Maybe. Of course not.
No, it's not 1996, but director Wes Craven is back with Scream 4. I'm Christy Lemire of the Associated Press.
And I'm Ignatiy Vishnevetsky of Mubi.com. Let's get right to it. Roger is in his office with a review of Scream 4.
The new horror film Scream 4 does a pretty good job of being Scream 4. And since that's probably what the Scream fans want, I guess it succeeds
Hello?
On its
Hello?
Own terms.
Hello?
I'm Bill Curtis for Roger Ebert. Like in the other Scream movies, the characters in this one are sophisticated about horror movies and devote dialogue to dissecting the genre before being dissected themselves. Even the voice of the killer seems to be in on the game.
Marnie was the brainy friend, so boring. That character always dies first.
That's not funny.
This isn't a comedy. It's a horror film. People live, people die, and you'd better start running.
Courtney Cox stars as the wife of the sheriff. She sees the return of the killer as her chance to get back her job as a TV reporter.
What if we could catch the killer by working together? Two generations of cutting-edge journalists intertwining our passions for media. What would you say?
I love you.
Very good.
Those are Eric Knudsen and Rory Culkin, who, like some of the other characters, talked like they hang out a lot at websites about horror films. Emma Roberts stars as the niece of Nev Campbell, who has been terrorized by Ghostface for what seems like forever.
You have no right to be in here, not anymore.
I heard you got a phone call from the killer.
What do you care?
Don't you think you'd be a lot safer with me around?
I don't trust you, Trevor.
David Arquette plays the local sheriff, trying to track down who has been receiving threatening phone calls.
This whole situation's under control.
Scream 4 reunites the team of director Wes Craven and writer Kevin Williamson, who have mastered the idea of horror film, where the characters know all about horror films. That provides some good moments, especially at the beginning, but the movie satirizes horror movie cliches. But basically, the movie is devoted to one victim after another being slashed, skewered, stabbed, gutted, and sliced. And maybe that's your idea of a good time. But it's not mine.
Thanks, Roger. Our next film attempts to tackle a difficult subject and loses. It's called Trust, and it stars Clive Owen and Catherine Keener as the parents of a teenage girl who's raped by an online predator. It all starts innocently enough when the girl connects with an older boy named Charlie in a volleyball chat room.
He's a junior and plays volleyball for his high school.
Oh, a junior. Well, he's obviously a very smart kid. LOL. Laugh out loud, right?
Nice one, Dad.
Proms.
Parent watching over my shoulder.
That older boy turns out to be a significantly older man who coerces the girl to having sex with him. After the incident, the girl begins meeting with a therapist, but refuses to admit that she was raped.
There are girls at my school who've had sex with half the football team. I lose my virginity and my parents make a federal case out of it. Literally.
I think they're more concerned that you may have been in danger more than anything else.
Danger? That's because they don't know him. You know, the thing is, I bet my dad would really like him.
Her father, in the meantime, becomes obsessed with violent fantasies of hunting down and killing the perpetrator.
The night I had this dream, I'd got him. I was beating the life out of him. I was on top of him and I was punching him and punching him and his face was caving in. There was blood going everywhere and I could actually taste it. I woke up, I found I'd actually chewed the inside of my mouth. It's my own blood I was tasting.
Now, one thing the movies are especially suited for doing is forcing people to look at things that they'd rather not think about. Trust, however, lacks that kind of commitment. It certainly has the cast to confront the complexities at hand. Owen and Keener make a convincing married couple, and Liana Liberato is unsettling as the daughter when she's given the opportunity. But the film, instead, chooses to merely acknowledge the issues and then move on. And the result is little more than a well-acted series of loose ends and cop-outs. It's thumbs down for me.
My thumb is a little bit up, not hugely enthusiastically up. This might have seemed shocking 15 years ago, you know, the advent of chat rooms and the idea of kids being potential prey. That certainly still exists now in myriad forms, texting, whatever, Facebook. So it's still relevant, but it might have shaken us up a little bit more had it been made a long, long time ago. It also is a hair better than an after-school special about this topic, and that is because of the cast. Clive Owen's great in everything. Catherine Keener's great in everything. I'd never seen Liana Liberato prior to this, and she has these moments that are, you know, very raw and very believable. She's an innocent girl, and she changes a lot, and she reacts in very surprising ways to how this whole thing goes down.
I think this film, there's a potential here with the subject and with this cast. And I think there's only one scene for me where it realizes that potential. And that is the meeting between the girl and the predator in the motel room. And it is uncomfortable. And it is, you know, really confronting these issues. Because there's not only this, you know, cyber predator thing going on, but there's also quite a lot about how people don't really want to think about their children's sex lives, you know, and about teen sexuality. That is really the only moment where it goes after that issue. Other than that, it feels like the film is trying too hard to make the subject palatable. It's something really difficult, and it should be confronted head on.
And the connection with, like, American Apparel ads and how those hypersexualized teens, it feels like a bit of a reach to say, like, that's the reason this kind of activity goes on.
But it's still an interesting idea. But, I mean, do you feel, because you're giving this a thumbs up, do you feel that the cast is worth it?
They definitely elevate material that might have seemed mediocre otherwise. And, again, the direction is kind of bland from David Schwimmer. This is his second film after Run, Fat Boy, Run. Didn't really grab you. But, again, performances are all strong.
Well, coming up next, Robin Wright in Robert Redford's The Conspirator.
You can't even see the truth.
But first, here's a look at movies now playing in theaters.
Counselor, control yourself.
I control the prosecution.
Mr. Aiken.
Every witness I wish to call has either been turned by a jail or the threat of it.
That's enough.
There is no limit to how far the prosecution is willing to go.
Stand down, Counselor.
That's a scene from The Conspirator, the latest film from Robert Redford. It explores an event in American history that most of us probably never knew about, the trial of Mary Surratt, a boarding house owner whose son was suspected of helping John Wilkes Booth assassinate Abraham Lincoln. James McAvoy plays Frederick Aiken, the lawyer assigned to defend Mary, played by Robin Wright.
You have to tell us where your son is.
Us? I have to tell us? Whose side are you on? I'm
trying to defend you.
By suggesting I trade my son for myself? You're trying to save you, Mr. Aiken.
The idealistic Aiken says he doesn't know whether Mary is guilty, but he feels she deserves a fair trial. The entire nation's against her, and against him, too, by association. But Kevin Kline, as the power-hungry Secretary of War, makes it clear that someone must pay for the president's death.
To ensure the survival of this nation, I would do anything. Mary Surratt was a party to the most grievous crime in our history. Necessity demands that she be given a swift, sure, and harsh sentence. I, too, hold sacred our rights, Counselor. But they count not at all if our nation ceases to exist.
The Conspirator is stately and respectable to a fault. It's too safe. Sure, it's got an excellent pedigreed cast, including Tom Wilkinson, Cole Meany, Danny Houston, and Stephen Root in one great scene. But I walked away feeling like I'd just been lectured to and not inspired.
Well, you know, this is going to make some high school history teacher really happy because they won't have to teach class for 4 days. You know, they just get to show a DVD.
From Robert Redford, of all
people.
From
Robert Redford, of all people. Watching this film, one thing that came to mind over and over again to me is that this is exactly the kind of material that, say, Clint Eastwood is able to turn into really nuanced explorations of national identity and of history. But the problem is that it's really heavy-handed.
Right.
And he really doesn't, attempt to control his cast and kind of move them towards a single goal. It's all over the place.
Yeah, there's not a lot of subtlety here in the performances. Robin Wright is always like the proud martyr, and James McAvoy is always indignant, and Kevin Kline's always kind of like mustache twirling in his villainy. And then there's Justin Long, speaking of mustaches.
Alternate title for this film is Justin Long Reaction Shot, the movie. Justin Long, who plays a Civil War veteran in this movie, wears a terrible fake mustache. He looks like he belongs in an SNL skit
about the Civil War. Yeah. And Redford shoots all the interiors the exact same way. The rooms are all dark with like the slats of misty light coming through. It's suffocating.
Yeah, well, also opening this weekend is Rio, which is hopefully much less suffocating and much more sunny. Roger's back in his office with the review.
The new 3D animated comedy Rio is upbeat and colorful and a lot of fun. I'm Bill Curtis for Roger Ebert. It tells the saga of a rare blue macaw named Blue, who is captured in Brazil and shipped off for pet stores in America. He's so young, he hasn't even learned to fly yet. A parrot scientist brings Blue back from America because he's the last surviving blue macaw in the world. And unless he mates with a girl parrot named Jewel, his species will die. Jewel, Jesse Eisenberg is the voice of Blue. Anne Hathaway is Jewel. And that's George Lopez as Raphael, sort of a matchmaker.
Eva, my love, I must take this young couple to see Louise.
You and your amigo just want to sneak off to Carnival.
That magical time when I met the most beautiful bird in the world.
The would-be lovebirds are captured by smugglers and chained together. And Raphael helps them escape.
We gotta go!
Need a lift?
Whoa.
Rio has a lot of music by everyone from Sergio Mendes to Will.i.am. The animation is by the same team that makes the Ice Age movies, and it's a riot of colors. Birds, in my opinion, don't make the most charismatic of animated characters, but so much is happening that doesn't matter. This is a good choice for younger viewers, although maybe a little routine for their parents.
Okay, thank you so much for that, Roger. Our next movie is Henry's Crime, a comedy starring Keanu Reeves as a guy who goes to prison for a bank robbery he didn't commit. But that's okay with him. Reeves plays Henry, who's stuck working the overnight shift at a toll booth in Buffalo. When some high school friends ask him to play softball one day, and they stop at the bank first, he ends up spending time behind bars for driving the getaway car. That gives him a chance to start over, and it gives him an idea.
So what do you say?
What do I say about what?
Will you help me?
Help you what?
Will you help me rob the bank?
You came to jail to ask me to help you rob a bank?
Yeah.
I missed you, Henry.
That's James Caan as Henry's cellmate, a smooth-talking con who ends up helping him with a scheme once he gets out.
How long has that vault been here?
Since 1891.
Wow. And I'm just assuming it's in the same spot on that, right?
Oh, yeah, exact same spot.
Mr. Son, I'm telling you, it's all about history.
The plan involves digging through an old bootlegger's tunnel that connects the bank vault with the town's community theater, where they're staging Chekhov's The Cherry Orchard. Vera Farmiga is the play's brassy and volatile star.
You see, here on stage, every moment, every word, every breath should be a risk. Where is your risk, Jula?
I don't know, Derek, in your...
Good! Finally, she's listening.
Now, I don't want to tell you where Henry's crime goes from here, because while it may seem a bit predictable, the writing is so smart and so snappy, and the performances are all so great, it all feels fresh. This is a very clever little movie that is definitely worth seeking out. Thumbs up.
You know, Keanu Reeves has this natural blankness where he sort of has this air like he's, you know, an amnesiac who doesn't really remember who he is, but he doesn't want anybody else to know. And I think barring like an adaptation of Bartleby the Scrivener, this is a perfect conduit for this role, for that particular quality that he has as an actor. And I think everyone in this film is equally perfectly cast. I mean, I've got to say, this has got to be James Caan's best performance in at least like 20 years.
Decades, yeah. No, I love Keanu Reeves in this. I think it's a brilliant little bit of casting. Mm-hmm. The idea that he is Neo, he's the one. But here, he's a toll booth guy.
Yeah.
He's a blank slate. And yet, again, I don't want to give too much away, but he gets a chance to show there's a lot more to him than that. He gets to sort of flip a switch and become a totally different guy sometimes. Mm-hmm. And that is hugely captivating because you're like, where did that come from?
And there's an eccentricity to the film, but it doesn't become... I think it doesn't become gratingly quirky.
Like so many little independent comedies
Like so
are,
many
right?
independent comedies. There are all of these odd bits to it. There's a really great, the soundtrack to the film, which is all stuff off of Daptone Records. A lot of kind of soul mm-hmm. revival. Everything about this film is kind of unusual, but it all works. You know, I found this really entertaining and a lot of fun.
I always like Vera Farmiga. I know she prefers to do supporting roles, but wherever you see her, whether it's this or Up in the Air or The Departed, you always want to see more of her. So
yeah,
she's
no,
great in this.
She's really good in this. It's true. Okay, up next, our contributor Cartina Richardson takes a look at the classic Thin Man series of films. Here's Cartina.
When I'm feeling down, the first people I turn to brighten my day are Nick and Nora Charles and the Thin Man movies. Nick and Nora were the beloved stars of the 6 Thin Man movies. The first, The Thin Man, was released in 1934, and the last, Song of the Thin Man, in 1947. William Powell played Nick Charles, a detective that makes being perpetually drunk look elegant, while Myrna Loy played his sarcastic wife, Nora. Together, Nick and Nora guided Americans through 2 of the darkest times in the first half of the century, the Great Depression and World War II. Their glamorous, sexy, but firmly unpretentious life was an ideal for a depressed and raggedy public. Now, these movies are actually murder mysteries, but the murders don't matter.
After the first watch, the cases become accessories. I don't care who killed Stinky Davis anymore. I watch for Nick and Nora. Now, I think the reason we return to Nick and Nora over and over again is because of the dialogue, the witty zingers. And that's true in a way, but it's really what that exchange represents that brings us back.
Well, I've done my duty.
I wonder what's up.
Up where?
Up there.
Where?
There. And it comes out here.
The Charles's share an intimacy so rare, few people dare to believe in its existence. True security without a whisper of boredom.
Smart gal.
In the Charles's world, faults are never irritating. Nora teases Nick about his vices, and Nick patiently foils Nora's Lucy Ricardo-esque attempts at sleuthing.
Got any complaints or suggestions?
Few.
Which?
Complaints.
I'd shoot.
Well, you don't scold, you don't nag, and you look far too pretty in the mornings.
Well, I'll remember. Must scold, must nag, mustn't be too pretty in the mornings.
But these aren't serious problems. Nothing truly threatens the Charles's union. Their love is a fact. Nick and Nora have fun with each other. They splash around in their love. It's not something to be handled with kid gloves. Yeah, the Thin Man movies have a lot of genius wisecracks in them, but when Nick and Nora interact on screen, they calm us. Their security is our security. This is the true beauty of mystery duos. We get all the drama and danger of crime sleuthing, and all the comfort and safety of a healthy, loyal relationship. We desire, perhaps more than anything else, loyalty in all forms, from friends, family, lovers, even pets. We need it in our lives, even if it's in a movie. You see, Nora will always be with Nick, and Asta the dog will always be with Nick and Nora.
And I don't mean anything in the world, darling, but you and a toothbrush.
Thank you, Cartina. Now it's time for our Hot and Now segment. Here's a look at some movies now available on DVD. Now, my pick for Hot and Now this week is the most recent film by the woman I consider to be the most original director to come along in the last 25 years, Claire Denis. It's called White Material, and it stars Isabelle Huppert. She's part of a once wealthy white family that runs a coffee farm in an unnamed African country gripped by civil war.
Je vous connais tous, hein? Toi, t'es Peter Nambo, toi, t'es François-Joseph, toi, t'es Samir, ton père, il me vend du grain.
Pourquoi tu parles de son père? Tu payes, tu passes.
The best way I could describe the film is that it's a sort of chamber drama, following a small set of characters, largely on the grounds of the farm, that has been taken apart and put back together in a different order, starting at the end and then skipping around. White Material is an entrancing, unnerving experience. It's just been released on DVD from Criterion, and you owe it to yourself to see this film.
My Hot and Now pick is also a French film. It's Le Cercle Rouge, the second-to-last film from the hugely influential director Jean-Pierre Melville. Alain Delon stars as Corey, a con who's been released from prison early and gotten wind of a lucrative new job. The same day he gets out, a murderer named Vogel, played by Gian Maria Volonté, escapes from the detective who's been escorting him. When their paths cross, each sees in the other a kindred spirit and a shared sense of honor.
Charmante façon de me remercier.
Tu m'avais vu monter dans ta voiture?
Bien sûr, sinon je ne t'aurais pas invité à en sortir pour te permettre de respirer.
Pourquoi avoir pris de tels risques? En l'air. Il répond à ma question.
Rends-moi libre de mes gestes, je peux pas te répondre autrement.
They team up to steal 20 million in jewels, but to call this a heist thriller would be a bit misleading. Exactly one word is said during the robbery itself. And yet, Le Cercle Rouge is completely engrossing. Le Cercle Rouge has been available on a Criterion DVD, but is out this week on Blu-ray. See it now before it gets remade, because that's coming. Okay, our next film is White Irish Drinkers, which I was surprised to learn is not a documentary about my family. It is, however, a low-budget and highly cliched look at working-class Brooklyn in the mid-1970s. Director John Gray's film is about two brothers, the sensitive artist, played by Nick Thurston, and the confident thug, played by Jeffrey Wigdor. Stephen Lang is their abusive, alcoholic father.
I didn't ask you to bail me out.
Yeah, well, it's the last time. Never again. Look, you don't come home tonight, huh? I don't want you in the house now. I don't want you there ever. You hear me?
Okay by me.
Bum is what you are. That's what you turn out to be, a bum. You understand?
Takes one to know one.
What did you just say?
The two come up with a plan to rob the theater where Thurston's character works on the night of the Rolling Stones concert. But he also finds time for a romance with his high school crush, played by Leslie Murphy.
He had you by the hair and he slapped it till you fell down. But you never made a sound. You just took it. Your face was so red and your shirt was coming out of your pants, but you didn't even cry. Kept his dignity. Brother Dominic lost his.
White Irish Drinkers is full of hammy acting, thick accents, and tedious expository dialogue. At one point, the brothers' white Irish friends stop drinking for a moment to announce that they are indeed white Irish drinkers. Thurston's got a couple of decent moments with Karen Allen, who plays the family's long-suffering matriarch. But the real crime here is that you have Allen in the same movie as Peter Riegert, who plays the theater owner, and they don't share a single scene. You've got Katie and Boone from Animal House together. You don't take advantage of it? Thumbs down on that alone.
Peppering, or I should say salting, all the dialogue with, you know, random expletives doesn't make it more authentic. It actually makes it more contrived.
Every other word is F.
Every other word begins with an F.
Yes.
You know, I normally kind of like these sort of modest genre movies, but this is just marinating in its own mediocrity, you know.
And alliterative to boot, nicely
yeah,
done.
Yeah, it's so bad I had to alliterate. It seems like it's a copy of a copy of a copy. You know, and if you go back far enough, you'll find like Mean Streets or something. But this is like sub, you know, early 90s Scorsese knockoff. If you just had a recording of someone saying like, my brother, and just, you know, looped it for like 2 hours, that would be this film.
Brudda, B-R-U-D-D-A-H, Brudda. Okay, recapping the movies on this week's show. We split on Trust. I liked it. Ignatiy did not. Two thumbs down on The Conspirator. Two thumbs up for Henry's Crime. Two thumbs down on White Irish Drinkers. Roger gives thumbs down to Scream 4. Plus, Roger gives a thumbs up to Rio.
Join us next week for our reviews of Water for Elephants, starring Reese Witherspoon and Robert Pattinson.
The world's run on tricks.
Everyone plays.
Also, don't forget you can join the discussion on Facebook and Twitter. Until then, the balcony is closed.
Out of Africa is nothing more or less than a great old-fashioned romantic love story, and I loved it on that basis. I like the chemistry that exists between Meryl Streep and Robert Redford, and I like the way that their characters are so clearly seen against that panoramic backdrop of East Africa. It's a beautiful movie to look at. It's a kind of a tearjerker to watch. I enjoyed it, and I give it 4 stars. I'm Roger Ebert.
For more reviews and more from Roger's office, visit our website at ebertpresents.com.